Hey, it's MK, and I am here for another Mixed Media Mayhem Hop for you guys. It is the last Friday of the month, and this is the layout that Sandy has picked for us today. It is by Jess Francisco. So I have this number set that I plan on doing this technique with, which is basically taking the color that I don't like and using alcohol markers or a Sharpie to color them the color that I want. Now, I also have to tell you guys that the larger alpha set, I plan on changing the color of the word awesome to. Either that or the word explore. I can't make up my mind. But that larger alpha set was actually gifted to me by Janet, and she was challenging me to step outside of my box. And Janet, I am proud to say that this is the last of your little challenge. And I used every single one of these little alphas and numbers, but not as they are, just to let you know that. All right. So I'm just sharing you guys all of the bits and pieces and scraps that I am using because I'm still playing along with Baby Got Scraps. but I realized that I have way too many scraps for this particular layout that we are lifting. So I'm going to try to incorporate most of them as I go. Now for my paint that I'm going to use on the background, I'm going to use Minte chalk paint, and I have the colors Bear and the color Mustard. I also have the color Sand. She's going slower than I am. And then I have this charcoal gray, which is called Anthracite. Yeah, I charcoal gray would have been way better. I do plan on applying them with my silicone paintbrush in 1.5 inches, but I also have to have a stir stick in order to mix up chalk paint. So chalk paint, let me introduce it to you really quickly, and this is going to go by super, super fast. But chalk paint is like almond butter. It separates over time. So the water sits on top and all of the chalk sits at the bottom. So you have to stir it up. And I mean like uber super good stir it up. And I have to do this for every single one of these inks. Now, if I was to use this on an everyday basis, I would not have to go through this process. But I only use it maybe about once a week. Maybe every other week, somewhere in there. It's something that I have out in the open that I do reach for when paint is called for. But to be honest, I don't use them enough to where I can't skip this process. If you don't do this all the way, then what you're going to end up doing is you're going to take out all that water and be left with just a clump of clay at the bottom of your pot, and it's not going to be any good. So the water that comes with your ink is definitely preferred. But when I get to my black, I think I started using it before I stirred it on accident, because I know better than that. It was definitely on the dry side. If you do have to add water, make sure that it is distilled, so that way it can live inside your pot with your paint. But it is supposed to be this nice milky paint, but it's supposed to also have a little bit of body to it. It's not supposed to be a free-flowing paint. So I'm going to go and do the exact same thing with the other four pot or the other three pots. Now for this one, I was trying to do the technique that Jess did in her blog. Actually, it was Ranger's blog. I went and looked it up just to see how she applied her paint and was able to get the black going all the way across. I was like, how does she do that? So what she did was she actually used paint that was in squirt bottles and squirted the paint all down her page. Well, clearly I don't have squirt bottles. So I was trying to dab the paint down. But the thing about chalk paint is that it dries uber super fast. And so as I was dabbing, it was drying. So I'm getting a few smears by the thicker blobs, but definitely not the smooth motion that I was looking for. So I'm just going to dip my brush and wipe my brush and dip my brush and wipe my brush and then scrape it down the page and then just fill in the colors where I would like them to come back through. So I really liked that mustard color. Oh my gosh, it is the perfect cat yellow color. If anybody knows what I'm talking about, just say, hey, because it was just the perfect color. I couldn't pass it up. And then, of course, I wanted a dirty layout. You know, I mean, they're pictures of dirt, to be honest. Okay, so now I'm showing you guys how I intend to use my letters. So inside Jess's layout, she used a stencil that is a large number stencil and a small number stencil. And I don't have those. I didn't have those. And if I did, I probably still would not have used them because of the fact that I have so many numerical thickers, stickers, chipboard pieces that I just, why not? I really wanted to use them up, in all honesty. Now, there is a huge contrast between my large numbers and my small numbers. Could I have made up a difference? Probably, but I do like how it ends up looking in the end. So I'm going to go ahead and let my numbers dry, let my background dry for a little bit, and work on my photo mats. And what I'm doing is I'm taking this 49 and Market old school paper that is left over from a long layout, a layout long time ago. And I really like the rivets. So I really want to figure out how to make them a part of my layout, but I don't want to take up too much of that background because, as you notice, I am using two photos. None of them are 4x4. They're both 4x6, so they're going to take a lot of space on this layout. They're going to dominate over my paint smears. And so I'm trying to keep everything contained to where I still get those paint smears. But you know how that goes. In the end, it all gets covered up. I'm just saying that it is the life of the mixed media. Seriously, that's how it always works, you guys. So I definitely wanted that topographical map paper to be shown because that's pretty much what I'm looking at. And this is a mine. Well, this is my old mine that I used to work at. This was back in 2016, so I felt like it was fair for me to be able to show these pictures because it does not look a thing like this anymore. Actually, this is about 2 years before we had the big slough off, and half of the pit ended up falling inside of itself. No one was harmed. No one was hurt. Not even the equipment. Nothing was damaged because we have these instruments that monitor dirt movement, and we are able to, from the very first motion that is something's going to happen, we are able to evacuate. And we've been monitoring a little bit of movement for a long time, so we've stayed out of that side, which is the far side of where the photos are being taken, and just working on the one side. But of course, we clear the entire pit when it actually let go 2 years later. So anywho, also too, to let you guys know that it's actually called Gold Quarry, but it wasn't called Gold Quarry back when it first started. This pit, before it became a pit, was actually discovered in 1925 by a gentleman of the last name Burling. And he kind of dabbled here and there because back then it was, oh my God, gold, right? And then all of a sudden he stopped. And it wasn't until 1936 when he actually sold the property to another mining company. And they actually drilled the first hole to see how productive, how prosperous this pit was going to be. And I'm not sure, I don't want to speak geek talk to you guys, but honestly, there was a 3-to-1 ratio of gold to silver inside this, area. I can't really say pit because it wasn't a pit. And so anyways, they dabbled in it for a year or two. It really took them quite a while to develop. Look, Janet, I'm using them all. Maybe not visible, but I'm using them. So anyways, it took a while for them to develop. And it wasn't until 1982 that my company, Newmont, actually purchased this mine and the entire compound, I should say, which is huge, by the way. So Newmont took over in 1982, and they didn't actually, produce their first gold bar until 1988, when they, you know, because it takes a lot of exploration drill to find the right veins, to find out where the gold goes, what direction, and all that stuff. And so anyways, 1988 was the very first gold bar that came from this pit. And they've been drilling there ever since. And they are still there today, drilling in this pit. However, the pit is quite smaller because we did have that slough off. And we didn't need to go back in and clear out the slough. We were pretty much done with that side of the pit anyways. The cool part about the mines, if you guys aren't aware, is they have a reclamation contract. A reclamation contract basically means that when we are done with this, when we are done getting what we need to get done, then we are going to go back through and put the earth back. We're going to make it back, make it right with the world. And so they will fill in these pits and then actually spread seeds around, so that way the plants will grow back. And it won't be harmed at all. I mean, yes, you'll still be able to see that it was kind of man-made and all that other stuff. But truth be told, that, you know, I think it's kind of cool. I actually watched where we were finished with a pit, and I actually watched the reclamation process. And it is really, really cool. And the few years that I stayed out in the mines, before, you know, I hit the desk, I actually got to watch it grow. And it literally filled in before my eyes. It was so cool. And you couldn't even tell that it was there except for a few lines, the unnatural lines, of where you could see where we used to dig with equipment. That was it. And one of the other fun facts that I wanted to share with you guys, it actually dug out 255 million tons of dirt in 2016. So from January 1st to December 31st, that's how many tons of dirt it moved. And it also did 5.2 million ounces of gold, which is 39% of Newmont's profit, basically. So it filled 39% of Newmont's quota, I guess I should say, for the year. And then a total of 8.5 million ounces from the start of 1988. No, I lied. 8.5 million ounces is how much they have in reserve on the ground. So they can't actually produce all the gold all at once. So what they do is they make stockpiles until the leach pad is ready to produce the gold or ready to leach out the gold. And so in reserve on the ground, which I'm not supposed to tell you guys this, but it's interesting to know, you know, that there's an estimated of 8.5 million ounces that can be leached out. Now, from the naked eye, all it is just dirt. They're piles of dirt, right? But because they are dug out and put in a specific spot, that is exactly where, you know, that's how they are able to figure out how much they assume of gold is in that dirt. So anyways, I just thought that I'd throw that fun fact out there for you guys. So truth be told, I did end up covering up all of my paint smears, which I'm fine with. I love the little bit that it's peeking out and all that stuff. I'm not so sure about the background still being stark white, especially for a dirty layout. I don't know, but I'm going to leave it the way it is for now, and then see if I like it. If it bothers me so much as I'm flipping through my album, then I might pull it out and ink the edges. I'm not really sure, but I'm going to try to not and leave it as is. I really am. I'm going to try to leave it white like that. Ooh, that's scary. Anyways, be sure to check out everyone else that is hopping along with us for our Mixed Media Mayhem last hop of the month. And what we do in our Facebook group is we post this photo or this layout for anyone to join us. And you do not need to have a YouTube channel. You can just join in and have some mixed media fun with us. We love to see everybody's different outlooks and creations from an inspiration. It's awesome. It's fun. So give it a try. If you guys aren't a part of our Facebook group, it is linked down below. in the description box. So check it out. And I will check y'all later. Bye.